Mike.
What I'm going to show you now, seeing that he's got that up, I'm going to show you paintings. That some of them are 4,000 years, 45,000 years old. And in South Africa, it's full of these paintings. They are gradually being destroyed. I don't know whether you're going to see them very well. Let's go through the paintings. And as I say, some of them are imposed on other ones. We can't read the writing under there. What can you see there? Maybe you can see more than I can see.
Would you like me to read?
Am I in somebody's way? This is a rhinoceros, which is picked out of the thing, out of the rock.
I'd keep it.
Let's just go through those and then I'll talk about the Bushman.
Just go through them.
It's a rhinoceros. And this is an elot. You can recognize the animals if you know them. There's a roan antelope, and we should see some elephants on the side there. There's some those elephants there. I don't know whether you can see them.
These
I need a pointer, yes. Now, these were I took in photographs in Rhodesia, and unfortunately, the little pygmies were using their catties, I don't know what you call
slingshot,
but they were doing stones and just aiming at the animals, so they've been destroyed, and people from universities come and try and dig them away so they can take them to the places. So there's been a lot of disruption of these paintings. Now these are on a farm called Missouri, and there are great big rock faces, and the faces are full of these drawings, paintings, and you can see that some are superimposed on others, and I don't know whether you'll see very clearly there, but there are, you can see brown paintings at the back, which are very, very old, and then people have painted on top of them again, so that you can see three layers of paintings of different periods. Now, the original paintings, the ones that have been dated to 45,000 years, are by far the most beautiful of animals, and they don't, you would expect what we call primitive people to do little stick figures, but they weren't stick figures. They were animals in movement. You had pictures of animals looking round like this and in different attitudes. And in fact, I tried to draw one and I was busy copying, and to me, I could see this animal. And when I went to draw it, I found that the lines were not all there. For instance, you have an animal looking round like this, there's a line like this, and a line here, and a line here, and my eye put in the rest of the picture. This is what we would call advanced art, but this is the sort of art that they did, the early art. As you can tell, the later art, when the black people started coming in, they started making pictures. When they did animals, it was probably they did it in the process of a spiritual activity, because they wanted to get to the soul of the animal, and they wanted to apologize to the animal for needing to eat its flesh. And they needed to know the animal well before they could kill the animal and eat it. And so those paintings are very beautiful. And as you come with native paintings, where they painted the native people coming down, who used spears and not bows and arrows like they did, and then eventually I'll show you pictures of the first white people that they saw, they tried to, they couldn't understand that they had oxen to carry them, to take their tents. You know, like when you people trekked across America, the people in South Africa trekked with a covered wagon and 18 oxen. There's always 18 oxen. And these people didn't understand using animals for things like using sheep, using cattle. That wasn't what they did. They were hunter-gatherers, and they believed that the game were there. They were out of their world, and if they saw game, they would shoot it. And they found that people's cattle, which the black people had brought down with them, or the Hottentots also brought cattle down, they thought they were just there for them to kill. And so this wasn't really accepted by the people migrating down, because they owned the cattle, and it wasn't really up to anything to the whites, who also had difficulty keeping their cattle, and they didn't appreciate that the little bushmen would come and shoot their animals, and they would take them and put them in jail, or shoot them, or do something like that, because they didn't understand their culture, if they did, they wouldn't have accepted it, I'm sure. But anyway, they eventually, let me finish with the paintings, and well, you can go on with the next one. Can you? And just go through them, because they're not very clear. This is the country that it's in. This is part of Rhodesia. And here you'll see, hold it for a bit, you will see that the brown paintings are the older ones, and the darker ones are the ones that have come, that's right, have been laid on top. And you can see what those animals are. That big one up there with the horns is a roan antelope. And then we will see lots of elands. Okay, thank you. And the same thing with there. Remember, the age of these paintings is very old. Now here we have pictures, that last one was pictures of the black people coming in and fighting and using spears, as opposed to them using bows and arrows. Okay. And again, you can just go on until I stop you. Okay. You'll notice that when they have men there, they have big legs and they have big bottoms. Now, the bottom is big because they would go, just like a camel has a hump, where he stores his food. The people, the Herero people and the Bushmen, and probably the Hottentots, I'm not sure, but they all had large behinds, and it's portrayed in these pictures. Because, you see, I will talk about hunting in a moment. They would hunt the animals, and there's no refrigeration or anything like that, it's hot weather. So once you kill an animal, you sit down and you eat it. So it might take a week to finish an animal, right? And so they stored the food. Food and water were stored in their bottoms. And then they could go for a month or so with minimal eating. And so to the next time they could kill an animal. Now that animal is it looks like a Kuzu female, but I don't understand what the marks are there. That is probably of some significance. I haven't yet found out that sort of five-fingered thing that's around. It might be some of their spiritual activity. You see the little black ones are, you can tell them they're warthogs. And then in the background are these rather taller people that they've made in the dark, in the light colour, which are older than the darker coloured pictures in years. Yes, you've got a bit of pictures there than we've got there.
What do we have there?
No idea.
Yeah, okay. Next.
Yes, oh, fish.
No, they've not. No, they've not. Okay, carry on. Again. Your elephants again. Hold that one. If we can just concentrate. Now I want you to look at this. This is a cave. This is a home. Now when you don't have many things to clutter you down, but you need cupboards and drawers and everything else, and you only have, you haven't got clothes because you don't wear clothes. You might wear a little something in front, a little apron made of animal skin. In the cold weather you have an animal koros, which you wrap yourself up in. You have your bow, which must be very important, and your arrows. There's not much else. You need a cutting knife or something, because when the men go out hunting, the women know the plants extraordinarily well, and they know where to find plants that will give them water and food. But they live in a place like that. It's not a permanent residence because they are moving all the time. But how would you like to live in a cave that isn't even a cave? But it's a sort of way to live. Okay, shall we go on? Yeah, you can go on. I can see people's eyes are dimming over because they're tired of looking at pictures. So you can just go on a little speedy. Until we get to something interesting. I think that's probably... That is just a part of Rhodesia, of a park in Rhodesia. Rhodesia is now Zimbabwe, right? And this is part of the farm, the Zoe, where the Bushman paintings were, that I took pictures of. You can see birds in the trees up there, blackbirds, and just go on. This is interesting. I'll show you a split in the rock. There are these huge rocks. These rocks are put down by, they're igneous rocks, so they obviously come from volcanoes. Now, if you have a little split in a rock and the water drips down and a tree puts its roots down, eventually the rocks are parted because those roots are very strong. Those are roots coming down between the two rocks there. Okay, carry on. This is just part of Rhodesia. My sister. Here's another little cave. They're very shallow caves. Okay. I think it's the end. Here, again, you see, I wanted to show you the split in the rock. There. And you see the how beautiful these paintings are. They're exquisite, really, when you go to look at them in detail. The detail is unbelievable. It's an Elant. And here, I don't know how we're going to show it, but they're showing, these are when they saw the white people. There's a male figure here, not really clear on this, and a female figure, which they've done. I should imagine they thought clothes must have been strange sort of things that these people wore, because they just covered themselves with a koros when they were cold. Okay, I think that's the end of those. Is it? Here is quite interesting. I'm not sure. That's a female figure, and it might be showing her having a baby.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah, the things that we find funny are just part of the natural's, you know, just part of nature going on. The giraffe is lovely, it's a lovely painting. From an art point of view, the things are exquisite, but you have to see them in more detail than you can see in this kind of luck. Okay, hold that one. That is, it's supposed to be two females dancing. You see how they how they make the legs so much bigger, because they're dancing and they're demonstrating a dance. This is the dance. Can we go back?
Yes.
This is the dance of the mantis. Now the mantis is a we call it a god, for a better word. We used to call them Hottentot gods. You know, I'm talking about a praying mantis. You know what I'm talking about. You know what a praying mantis is. It looks like E.T. In fact, E.T. looks like it. It's got these big eyes, and it's got a face like E.T. That's the face of a praying mantis. You, next time you see a praying mantis, look at it and you think, why is E.T. like that? Why do we always show aliens looking like the mantis? And the funny part is that I went to Alaska and there was a museum for the Inuits being the, what do you call them, the Eskimos. Mm-hmm. And there was the Eskimo god, and what did he look like? Looked like a praying mantis. He had these big eyes and that little mouth and the face of E.T. Wasn't that interesting? Because it was the same as these people had. There's strange things in this world. Anyway, these are two females doing a mantis dance. So this is, see the big feet. They never thought much of faces and heads. They didn't know about brains, I guess. So most of their figures don't really have heads or faces, but they have big legs or whatever they do. Okay, this is a pity that it doesn't show up a little better. This is also a rather nice animal figure, which is, yeah. Is it an eland?
Yeah, this is the beautiful one. That's what got this
So it's chipped out of the rock and it's a beautiful figure. It's in the art gallery at Pretoria. Okay. And that is a quokka. Now a quokka is an interesting animal which is now extinct. The quokka looks like a zebra. It has zebra markings on its front half and not nothing in the back half. And now they have found an animal like that in North Africa somewhere. And we're not sure whether it's a quokka or not. I think if you go to the Pretoria, the St. Louis Zoo, you'll see an animal that looks like a quokka. And it's got the stripes in front, and it's got, you know, no stripes on the back of it. I think it's got stripes on its legs, if I remember right. But that's a quokka. And the early settlers saw quokkas, but they probably shot them out. And, yeah.
Reebok.
It's a, yeah, Reebok. But, really beautiful paintings, okay. Yeah. And that's a picture of, can we see it? Not very well. Those are just a lot of cattle there. They found it very interesting seeing the cattle because they weren't, they were slow moving creatures and they were easy to kill.
That's all pictures?
That's all. So we can stop the pictures and I'll talk some more about it. I'll just talk more about the Bushmen. Okay. can be heavy enough.
Are you done with your computer?
Huh?
Are you done with your computer?
Yeah. I'm sorry they weren't as visible as they are on the computer, because they really rather nice pictures. Bushman used the bow and he used... Let's get some more things out here. There are some Bushman paintings that you can hand around if you like. That would be a good idea. You'll get a better idea. I have marked every page where there are pictures. If you want to see other pictures of an animal, rather if you didn't find those interesting. So, okay. Now, how long have they been there? They've been there forever. And they think that they are the direct descendants of early man, you know, the ones that were pre-men that they found in South Africa. That's good. I don't need to tell you about humans. There's a... Somebody copied some pictures that were awful. For the same reason. When they've had a good meal, they don't have so many wrinkles. A good meal doesn't take my wrinkles away. But anyway, that's a picture of a Bushman. And here he is. Did you see this? His bow. He used a big bow. And I'll talk about the little one. He actually used... He didn't use these little ones. He used, a long bamboo for his to hold his arrow. But he used little arrows, which he put. He made a poison from a worm, a caterpillar that was poisonous. He would put on his on the end of his bow, of his arrow. And then he would shoot it into the animal, and then of course the animal wouldn't die straight away, and he would have to follow it until it dropped, and then they would sit down and eat it. The ostrich egg, which is there, you've seen, they used, once they got to the Kalahari, which there's not much water in the Kalahari, occasionally, the rain would make a little puddle. It would rain maybe every 10 years or something. And they would take the ostrich eggs and they would fill them with the water. You took the ostrich egg, you made the hole in the top. Of course, you poured out the inside to eat. And once you cleaned out the inside, then you put a straw one straw into the egg, one straw into the little puddle, and then you would suck up the water from the puddle and put it down into the ostrich egg until it was full, and they would plug it, and then they would go and put it somewhere so they would know where it was when they needed water. Okay. Now, talking about arrows, we have... I'll talk about this first. Did I tell you something else? About 10 minutes, okay. I've just got enough to talk in 10 minutes. They have found beads that were made 4,000 years ago out of ostrich eggs. And this is one that I bought recently, which they had recently made out of ostrich eggs. So they've been doing it, same old thing, for 4,000 years. None of this give me something new every time. But now we talk about this, is the most interesting part. Because, I don't know, maybe the other class I told them about it. This little quiver contained a bow, a little bow, and these little arrows. Now, you all, I bet you all know the story of Cupid. Do you? Cupid? Yeah. He shot an arrow into her heart, right? Well, I don't believe any of these myths or stories just are sucked out of somebody's thumb. I think they come from something. And here we have, in our very primitive people, no, not primitive, let me say early people, the early sand people, I don't think they were any less bright than we are. And they, when they wanted a girl, they would take their little tiny bow and have his arrows, and it would go off, and she would be running with no clothes on, and so he would take his little bow and he would shoot the arrow into her bottom. Now, if she wanted him, she would go on running. If she didn't want him, she'd pull it out and throw it away. But I think you'd think twice he was clever, because this is very barbed. And if you pull that out of your bottom, yeah, it's good. So you'd have to decide, do I like him enough, or is it worth pulling this out? So that's the way they made love. And Cupid, a heart never looked like that. So it's interesting. I think that I've talked enough. Do you want to see these pictures?
This is Goodman's class. You guys should go to the car gym and look around. You do need